Hello, and welcome back to IDG's Ahead of the Pack podcast, brought to you by AWS. Enterprises are looking for ways to capitalize on data to accelerate their business agility. Innovations in cloud, artificial intelligence, and machine learning provide tools and methods that address these opportunities and challenges. Ahead of the Pack is a series of podcasts with leading thought leaders who share their experience on how enterprises are leveraging these tools and the outcomes they are achieving. I'm Tim Crawford, CIO and Strategic Advisor at Avoa, and your host. Today's topic, how Formula One auto racing is using data and machine learning to change the experience both on the track and in the stands. Our guest today is Rob Smedley, Director of Data Systems for Formula One and AWS Technical Ambassador. Welcome, Rob.
Hi, Tim. Nice of you to have me on. Thank you very much.
It's great to have you on. And maybe to level set the conversation and to kick things off, let's talk about who Formula One is, your role at Formula One, and how Formula One has evolved.
So Formula One is the commercial rights holder of Formula One, the auto racing sport. We are the guys that define how Formula One looks, if you like. So Formula One is a very data-rich sport. We have, you know, the data that comes off the cars. We have timing data, which, you know, for each and every lap, many times per lap. And we have all sorts of other data points. So essentially, you know, every second we're streaming billions of data points back to the media and technology center in the UK from wherever we are in the world at a Formula One race. And because there's now this thirst for leveraging data and to bring about a more engaging fan experience, then my role was created, which is the director of data systems. So my role very quickly is to take everything data, to package that into bundles that our audience can understand and which helps to engage our audience and give them a better experience of a Formula One race.
That's great. And, you know, technology isn't new. You know, you talk about data, you talk about the changes within Formula One. Let's maybe dive a little further into that and talk about how machine learning also came into effect there.
So I think machine learning for me in Formula One goes back some years. You know, I actually come from the Formula One teams. So I've come from the team environment into the commercial rights holder, you know, central body. And so my initial experience of machine learning was within the team. So my last role was with the Williams Grand Prix team, where I was head of performance development within that Grand Prix team. And we're, you know, in a role like that, we're always trying to innovate. We're always looking at what the next thing is, and especially how we utilize the data in order to make the car go quicker. So, you know, our reason for being, if you like, a performance department in the Formula One car is all about the lap time of that car. And it's utilizing, you know, aerodynamic data. It's utilizing car data. Tire data itself. An important aspect of the tire data is how the tire wears during the race. The tire is a moving object in all sorts of senses of the word. The contact patch, i.e. the part that scrubs across the road, is constantly evolving as you put load across the car, downforce on the car. And so the tire wears in a very particular way. We built machine learning models which helped us to understand what the physical tire wear was. And if you understand what the physical tire wear was, you can reduce that tire wear. And by reducing that tire wear, you can bring about more performance in the race, make the tire last for longer, pit stop after everybody else has pitted, or do one less pit stop than other people. So this is a hugely important area. I also brought about, you know, we introduced machine learning for the physical tire model as well. So trying to understand the physics of the tire and how to generate more grip out of that tire. And machine learning was a great application for that. So this all happened like maybe, you know, 6-7 years ago in Formula One. certainly with the team that I was in. Now, I know that of other examples, you know, Formula One is a very competitive in the team environment. It's a hugely competitive area. So the teams that tend to keep, you know, their technical secrets very, very close to their chest. But, you know, there's other great examples of teams out there innovating and beginning to use machine learning, you know, for the purpose of trying to bring about more lap time to the car.
You know, it's interesting. We talked a little bit about this in the past and how technology and machine learning are fitting into tires specifically, but there are other aspects that it comes into play when you think about car design, when you think about different aspects to the experience. How are machine learning and cloud and high performance computing playing a role within Formula One?
So I think right now, you know, when we fast forward to today, you know, there's been some really cool analytics that we're trying to bring about to the viewer of Formula One. You know, if I take my role as director of data systems, and certainly the analytics that we're doing there with AWS have been really interesting. So you know, we're getting great feedback with the analytics and the applications that we're putting out on the live international feed. So for example, you know, stuff like pit battle strategy, the undercut strategy, tire performance strategy, all of these really, really important and key aspects during the race. And we're doing that via machine learning methods. So we're taking data off the cars, we're taking the timing data, we're building you know, reasonably complex algorithms and models in order to give us a predictive output. So the predictive output of the tire performance, if you like, when you look at the tire performance and you try to predict forward how long that tire is going to last at that performance and what the degradation is, this gives you then the viewer, the fan, a really key insight into, you know, when that car is going to pit, how long it can run on this particular tire, the performance of that tire compared to a rival car. And these are really, really, you know, key insights and key aspects of a Formula One race. And we're doing that because we're able to predict, you know, and forecast what the future is going to be, the short-term future is going to be, via machine learning algorithms. And then if you take the other flip side of it, you know, we spoke about high performance computing and what we're doing up in the cloud there. Then the design of the 2020 two car was essentially pushed and accelerated by using Amazon cloud services, by using the HPC services that we've got there. We're able to get through a huge amount of computational fluid dynamics. Computational fluid dynamics is essentially a simulated wind tunnel, and it's a way to evaluate your car aerodynamically. But computational fluid dynamics is also very, very heavy in compute power, extremely heavy in compute power. But so having, you know, the cloud that we can spin up, you know, and it's like having a, you know, the biggest supercomputer ever, to be able to crunch through all of these numbers, you know, and all of these cells, whenever we want on tap. And some of the figures are absolutely mind blowing. I talked about it at reInvent last year in Las Vegas, and some of the figures that we've been able to you know, get in terms of cloud compute and the high performance there have been absolutely mind blowing. You know, stuff that we've never done before in Formula One.
No, that's really cool. And, you know, one of the things that you've talked about was the 2022 regulations, the 2022 car. When we spoke before, you talked a bit about the dynamics of the vehicle and the car design and kind of focusing on the back of the car. Maybe you could just spend a quick minute talking about what you mean by that and how that plays a role into CFD.
So what we set about trying to design a completely new generation of Formula One car, and we did that by looking at the problems. I think in any business, whether it's Formula One or whatever it is, your first port of call is to look at what your problems are, and then once you understand your problems, then you put in place a strategy for fixing those problems. And one of the key problems that we had, you know, especially from feedback from the fans who are our customer, was that they felt that there wasn't enough close action, not necessarily overtaking, but close action of Formula One cars on the track. It was, too few and too far between across a 90-minute or a 120-minute race. And that was principally driven by the fact that the cars generate so much downforce, i.e. the aerodynamic force that pushes them into the ground, the wake effect that comes off the cars, so that's the turbulent air, if you like, that is thrown off the back of the car, means that the car behind finds it very, very difficult to follow. You know, they lose more than half of their downforce when they're trying to get close to the car in front. And if you lose half of your downforce in a Formula One car, it's like losing half of your performance. So that means that, you know, you've got this vicious circle of the closer you get, the more downforce you lose. So, you know, you never have the performance when you need the performance to get close to a car in front and kind of battle with that car and have, you know, these really exciting wheel-to-wheel fights that go on during a Formula One race. That just can't happen because of the physics of the aerodynamics. So when we looked at that issue and we looked out to solve it, we needed to think about how we were going to redesign a Formula One car, you know, as the central body in collaboration with the governing body. And to do that, we needed to build a twin car CFD model. So a twin car computational fluid dynamics model where one car followed another car. And then we looked at the wake effect of car one, the car in front, and how that affected the car behind. So this was a hugely interesting problem for engineering geeks like me and trying to understand that. But the real key point here was that, even if you take a quarter car model, like we usually just model a quarter of the car because the computational power is so high, to do a run on a quarter car model can take, you know, upwards of 7-8 hours. As you then go from a quarter car to a full car, you increase the order of complexity of all of these, you know, the cell and node points, because it's just a series of cells, the air, if you like, the air is a mesh, and it's a series of cells what are all trying to solve to an equilibrium state. So when you go to a bigger model, which is the full car model, you have an order of magnitude more complexity. When you go to a two car model, you have about another order of magnitude complexity. So in, wow, in terms of runtime, then the runtime with the current technology and the current regulation set as to how much compute power you're allowed to use, was just going to be prohibitive. You know, we were talking days and days to solve one single run, and to be iterative, to have that really fast development rate that the aerodynamic engineers needed, we need to be solving runs in, you know, not in days or coming up to a week, but in hours. And the only way we could do that was to, you know, spin up thousands of cores in the cloud and bring about just mind-boggling numbers in terms of HPC. And wow, that was just really, really cool. And actually, we went from something that was going to take, you know, in the order of, you know, even weeks in some cases, depending on the complexity of the models, down to hours. And when I say down to hours, you know, we're getting down to, you know, four or five hours, which is just mind blowing in terms of, you know, how quick these things are processing.
So, how did this work before Formula One stepped in? You know, you've talked about how Formula One is now doing some of the computational analysis for the teams. How was it done before?
Well, quite honestly, Tim, it wasn't. You know, it was we designed the rule. We designed the technical regulations mainly in collaboration with the teams, you know, much more in collaboration with the teams. But of course, you got a very team-centric product. So, you know, the teams have their own interests. Of course they do, because they're separate entities and they're separate businesses, and each of them is trying to outperform the other. So when you sit down around a table and you ask the teams to help with that compute and brain power in order to design a brand new set of regulations, what you usually end up with is something that is perhaps not, you know, is very, very good for, you know, from the team's point of view, and some individual teams are better at this than others at coming up with a set of regulations that suits them. But very rarely something that is better from a fan point of view. And, you know, as the central commercial rights holder, we at Formula One were, you know, obviously our sole aim is to make a more sustainable and a more engaging Formula One. So we went about listening to our fans, and then we set about setting up, you know, technical departments within what is essentially a commercial rights holder body, setting a technical department full of, you know, people who we took from the teams, ex-team people, a little bit like myself, you know, people who had huge amounts of experience of designing Formula One cars already, and give them a slightly different challenge, which was not to make the fastest Formula One, but to make an engaging Formula One. So, you know, you still need all of the same skill sets and all of the same intellect and all of the same technology, but your aim is just slightly different.
Yeah. And I'd like to shift gears and talk about that fan experience a little bit. You know, sports of all types are looking for new ways to engage fans. How is Formula One using machine learning to engage their fans?
Well, I mean, you know, like I've you know, I alluded to it at the top of our conversation. You know, Formula One for a long time now has sat on what we refer to as this gold mine of data. You know, we have this absolute mind-boggling amount of data, and that's car telemetry data. So for each and every car, you know, Formula One as the commercial rights holder, we have most of the data that car generates. You know, some of the sensors are just particular for the teams, and the teams are able to hold on to that data. But a lot of the really good data that's going to be really interesting and really engaging for our fan base, where we can take off. We also own all of the timing data. So, you know, we can tell you anything about any car due to the timing. And that's been, you know, is a really important aspect. And then there's all the weather data. There's the tire data from the tire manufacturer. You know, there's many different layers of data. So it was about taking that data and then turning that into using that data or using subsets of that data to create what was effectively a more engaging experience for the fan. So something that the fan could kind of, you know, sit and get a much deeper understanding of the race and what was unfolding in front of them. And we've done that through, you know, by building machine learning algorithms principally, and taking, you know, the subsets of the data. You know, there's a lot of complex calculations that go on there and running through these algorithms, but then producing them and putting them on screen during the race to engage the fan in what I always refer to as human readable format. You know, so you know, we can't, it's not, you know, my peers as a group of engineers talking to me as another engineer and me understanding implicitly from a series of noughts and ones, because we're all a little bit geeky. You know, we gotta make sure that everybody understands everybody understands and can engage in these graphics that are popping up on the screen and telling them a story. You know, so there's a lot of complexity and a lot of math and physics that's going on in the background, but then actually the stuff that pops out on the screen is simple and engaging and brings about that excitement and that, you know, that tangible entry point into all of these different stories that are going on as this, you know, as a race is unfolding.
So Rob, let's talk a little bit about Deep Racer. How has Deep Racer played a role in the fan experience?
Well, you know what, we as at Formula One, Tim, we got involved in Deep Racer this year, and it was one of those really, you know, I would never like to refer to, you know, the COVID-19 virus as anything positive, but it was one of those things where we had to sit down and reevaluate as Formula One to think about how we were going to keep bringing, you know, a great experience to our fans, given the fact that there was no racing going on. And so, you know, it's one of those, you know, collaborative moments, which are becoming more and more common with AWS, where, you know, AWS actually approached us and said, what about, you know, doing something with Deep Racer. And when we looked at it, I certainly got excited quite quickly, as I always do, because it was tech. But that whole thing around, you know, that the whole thing around machine learning and engaging with not only a Formula One fan, but I think just fans of technology. You know, I think it's a really, really interesting thing, and bringing machine learning to a to an understandable level that people, you know, can get their heads around, and people can, you know, certainly understand. It's kind of like a toe in the water of machine learning. And when we looked at it, you know, it's got the autonomous racing. We brought about, you know, for want of a better word, a little bit of Formula One glamour. So we got two Formula One drivers involved. I was involved in kind of that whole coaching experience of you know, bringing the Formula One engineering part of it to the fore. And I just think it's just a really, really, you know, a great little snapshot of what Formula One is, because it's all of that tech, and it's all of that, you know, that leading edge thinking and intellect and all of that. And then it's translating all of that into something that is going to give you a competitive advantage. And then, you know, if you want to go on a little bit further, you've then got the, you know, for people who don't really care about the technology, they just want to see a competition, you know, they just want to watch that. And I think that, you know, at the end of it, you know, I was on Daniel Ricciardo's team and Tatiana Calderon's team. Tatiana's a test driver for the Alfa Romeo team. And Daniel is a race driver for the Renault team, and all three of us were really engaged in it. You know, it was a lot of fun, and it's one of those things that I really love as an engineer, because it's, you know, it's bringing about, it's educating people and showing them how powerful technology and in particular machine learning is, but doing it in a really fun and engaging way. So you know, that whole fan experience and engagement. I just think it was a great initiative, and definitely it's something that as a collaboration across Formula One and AWS, 100%, we want to you know, do something more with this and take it to the next level.
You alluded to this earlier in our conversation a little bit. Can you expand upon some of the things that you're doing with Amazon Web Services, especially when it comes to machine learning and the work that you're doing at Formula One?
Sure. Yeah. No. Absolutely. Well, I think it's been this is one of the most exciting parts of the project for me, because I've never had access to, you know, so much machine learning expertise, and I would like to think, you know, on the flip side, that AWS has, you know, has never had access before to so much Formula One expertise. And, you know, so it does feel, and we do act in a really, really collaborative way. So, you know, our main port of entry there is we set up a group within AWS ML Solutions Labs, which are the machine learning skunk works, if you like, the guys who are, you know, going, you know, they're kind of riffing with all sorts of different algorithms and different machine learning methodologies. In order to, you know, come out with, you know, different ways and different, you know, different methodologies and of ways of tackling these problems, and what we've done then, you know, that resource has been ring fenced, and they're concentrating solely on problems that we as F1 have set. But then on top of that, the really cool thing is that we've taken people from Formula One and we've embedded them into the team. So you get in this kind of super group. It's kind of like, I know I keep mentioning the word geek, but it's like the traveling Wilburys of geeks. We've taken like the really, the you know, some really cool, and you know, parts of all of the spectrum across the maths and physics and Formula One expertise, and kind of put them together. And we're just getting this melting pot, and it's just getting, we're just getting more and more good stuff out of that, you know. And I think, you know, by taking these, you know, really bright people in terms of machine learning and, you know, posing them problems from the Formula One sphere, and us from Formula One giving our input into, you know, methodologies, you know, a little bit more deterministic and traditional methodologies of how we would go about solving problems. And then, you know, kind of putting this melting pot together of you know, traditional and ML solutions. We're just embarking on some really cool projects, and you know, with that we're getting some really cool solutions as well.
Now that's really cool. That's really, really interesting. So as we kind of wrap on the episode, I have a question about, you know, what's next. What does, if you were kind of thinking about that list of things that you're trying to tick off, and that, but then also I'm sure some that might think, okay, well, if you're bringing so much technology into the Formula One calculations, does that potentially normalize the experience for both the fan as well as the driver and the teams? How are you protecting against that as well as you kind of think about where you go from here?
Well, it's a great question. You know, we don't want to mess about with the DNA of Formula One. You know, the DNA of Formula One has always been that the teams will push the technology. They will push to the very edge of technology and beyond sometimes, in order to gain a competitive advantage. And we don't want to take that away. You know, you've got to still allow areas where the teams can innovate. I guess what we're trying to do is we're trying to, you know, maintain those levels of innovation, because it's a really cool part of Formula One. I was involved on that side of it for 25 years, and it's a really, really cool part of it. So you don't want to lose that. But equally, what you can't have is you can't have teams that are allowed, you know, through their means of budget, if you like, allowed to just, you know, kind of innovate or develop at a much quicker rate than everybody else. So Formula One becomes a foregone conclusion that one team wins everything. I think that, you know, right, the fans would much rather see different teams winning every week. Now, whether or not we can ever get to that utopia, I'm not quite sure, but I'm sure that we can make some decent inroads here in terms of the you know, the variability of who wins. And that's what we've got to do. You know, we got to kind of be the gamekeeper, you know, marshal be the umpire, if you like, but do it in a fair way that the playing field is more balanced. You know, there's more opportunity for more teams, and it's a more exciting and a more engaging Formula One, but it still has that core DNA of innovation, of leading, you know, on the front foot of technology.
Yeah. No, that's great. Rob, thank you for joining the podcast and sharing your experience. This has been an insightful look at how Formula One is using machine learning to change the experience both on the track and in the stands. That's all for today's episode. Thanks for listening, and don't forget to subscribe. Catch all of the Ahead of the Pack episodes by visiting us on cio.com/podcast/Ahead of the Pack, or by finding us on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts. For IDG and AWS, I'm Tim Crawford with Avoa.
This podcast has been produced by IDG Communications in association with its sponsor, AWS.